From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to the JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. Thanks for joining us. I'm your host, Dr. Karen Lasser, professor of medicine at Boston University and senior editor at JAMA. Today, I am joined by Dr. Maria Papaleontiou, who is an associate professor of medicine at the University of Michigan and will be speaking about hypothyroidism. Welcome, Dr. Papaleontiou, to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast.
Thank you, Dr. Lasser. It's a pleasure to be here.
It's a pleasure for us likewise. So to begin with, how common is hypothyroidism and what are the main risk factors?
Prevalence of hypothyroidism actually depends on several factors, including, for example, iodine nutritional status of an area. So it can range between 0.3 to 12% worldwide. Particularly, the prevalence is higher in areas with inadequate nutritional iodine levels, such as regions of sub-Saharan Africa and Asia. And it's a little bit lower in North America and Europe, ranging between 0.3 to 2%. There are several risk factors that are correlated with primary hypothyroidism, which is what we will focus on today, particularly for the most common cause of primary hypothyroidism, which is Hashimoto's thyroiditis and is autoimmune. The main risk factors are female sex with a female-to-male ratio of approximately 5 to 1, genetic predisposition, with hypothyroidism being more common in Asian and white individuals compared with Black individuals, environmental factors, as we mentioned, living in areas with inadequate nutritional iodine levels, and also presence of other autoimmune diseases, such as type 1 diabetes and rheumatoid arthritis. I wanted to also mention that for this autoimmune thyroid cause of hypothyroidism, individuals with Down syndrome and Turner syndrome also have a higher risk of developing the disease. For non-autoimmune causes of primary hypothyroidism, risk factors include thyroid surgery and radiation therapy, pregnancy, and there are a slew of medications that are associated with increased risk of primary hypothyroidism as well.
Mm-hmm. So many risk factors. Now, how do patients with hypothyroidism typically present?
So this is a great question, particularly for clinicians, because as we know, a lot of the signs and symptoms of hypothyroidism are nonspecific. Some of the most common signs and symptoms we see are related to metabolic slowing due to the insufficient thyroid hormone production, and this includes fatigue, weight gain, cold intolerance, constipation, low heart rate, and cognitive impairment.
And I thought it was interesting in your review that you also mentioned that hypothyroidism can cause insulin resistance and hyperglycemia in patients with diabetes.
Yeah, so in general, hypothyroidism can exacerbate cardiovascular risk factors. And we most often think of these as increased risk of dyslipidemia, with cholesterol levels being increased, particularly low-density lipoprotein cholesterol. However, we do know that for patients with diabetes who either are untreated or undertreated for their hypothyroidism, there is a decrease in insulin sensitivity, and this can impair the movement of glucose from the bloodstream into the cells for energy or storage and makes glucose control difficult.
Mm-hmm. And can you also comment on how hypothyroidism affects reproductive health in women?
Yes, and this is an important one. As I mentioned, hypothyroidism pretty much affects all organ systems in the body. In women in particular, hypothyroidism can cause menstrual irregularities, including menorrhagia, oligomenorrhea, anovulation, and infertility. While in men, this can cause low libido, erectile dysfunction, and reduced sperm mobility, which may contribute to male hypogonadism.
And I thought it was interesting in your review, you mentioned that hypothyroidism also can increase the risk of miscarriage.
Yeah, that is correct.
So moving on to our next question, how is hypothyroidism diagnosed?
Hypothyroidism is a biochemical diagnosis, and the diagnosis is based on serum thyrotropin, also known as thyroid stimulating hormone, or TSH for short. And this is a blood test that typically we do in patients who may have symptoms suggestive of hypothyroidism, or in patients who may be evaluated for other conditions, such as dyslipidemia or infertility. So the main reason we recommend serum TSH as the initial diagnostic test, it's because it is the most reliable indicator of thyroid status in the outpatient setting, particularly in patients who don't have any clinically suspected pituitary or hypothalamic disease and who are not taking any medications that can affect TSH secretion. It does have a high sensitivity of 98% and specificity of 92% in identifying overt thyroid dysfunction. If the thyrotropin or TSH level is high, then this should be repeated along with a free thyroxine or T4 to confirm the diagnosis.
And I know in my lab, we do the TSH, and if it's high, it automatically reflexes to the thyroxine test. Is that okay, or should we really be repeating the TSH?
Yeah, I think this is a tricky question. Traditionally, the recommendation is to repeat the blood work. We also have a TSH with reflex, free T4 and free T3 at our institution. And partly, I think that also is a clinical judgment call in terms of how high the TSH ends up being before initiating treatment.
That makes sense. And which patients should be screened for hypothyroidism, meaning they should be tested even if they're asymptomatic?
So the recommendations regarding screening for primary hypothyroidism are actually highly variable among different societies and organizations. Specifically, the United States Preventive Services Task Force in 2015 concluded that there was insufficient evidence to recommend either for or against screening for primary hypothyroidism in asymptomatic non-pregnant adults. However, the endocrine societies, including the American Thyroid Association and the American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists, actually recommend screening with serum TSH for certain high-risk groups, and this includes individuals with autoimmune diseases such as type 1 diabetes or primary adrenal insufficiency, individuals with a history of thyroid disease in a first-degree relative, and also individuals exposed to head and neck radiation. And as I mentioned earlier, because individuals with Down syndrome and Turner syndrome have a higher risk of developing primary hypothyroidism, the American Academy of Pediatrics also recommends that they should undergo TSH screening annually.
Now, what is an appropriate initial levothyroxine dose for primary hypothyroidism, and how should patients be monitored while they're taking it?
Levothyroxine, which is the synthetic form of the thyroid hormone thyroxine, or T4, is first-line treatment for patients of hypothyroidism. And the recommended full adult dosage is 1.6 micrograms per kilogram of actual body weight per day. However, the initial dose should really be individualized, and we recommend that lower doses should be prescribed for older patients and for those who may have cardiovascular comorbidities. And the reason for this is to try to avoid overtreatment, with the initial levothyroxine dose in these individuals ranging between 25 to 50 micrograms per day. In terms of monitoring, typically we monitor with TSH. So TSH or thyrotropin levels are typically checked 6 to 8 weeks after initiating levothyroxine therapy. This is also recommended after switching the dose or the preparation. And once the TSH level has normalized, we recommend TSH checks annually. We also recommend that serum TSH is checked if there's a change in weight of 10 pounds or 4.5 kilograms or greater, because the levothyroxine dose is weight-based, or if the patient is experiencing any new symptoms suggestive of worsening hypothyroidism, or if there's initiation of medications that could affect thyroid function.
Great, that's very helpful. And now, what are some of the sequelae of untreated hypothyroidism?
Yeah, so as I mentioned earlier, there's definitely evidence to show that untreated hypothyroidism can exacerbate cardiovascular risk factors and events. This includes dyslipidemia, diastolic hypertension, increasing likelihood of cardiovascular disease in general, including heart failure and worsening glucose control. And if left untreated, severe hypothyroidism can lead to a life-threatening condition called myxedema coma.
Mm-hmm. Now, when should patients with hypothyroidism be referred to an endocrinologist?
Yeah, thank you for this question. Traditionally, patients with hypothyroidism are treated by primary care clinicians. So when thinking about referral to an endocrinologist, this should be considered for patients with hypothyroidism if they're planning conception or are pregnant, if they have a cardiovascular disease or other endocrine disorders such as adrenal and pituitary disease, if they have medication-induced hypothyroidism, if they have a history of thyroid cancer because goals of treatment may be different, or if they're being treated with levothyroxine, but the primary care clinician is having difficulty maintaining a euthyroid state, or their results are difficult to interpret.
Great. Is there anything else you think generalists should know about hypothyroidism?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of things. One of the things that we haven't talked about is the significance of over and under treatment of hypothyroidism. And this is something that has come to light in the last few years and has become the subject of increased study in the thyroid community, partly because there are several observational studies that have shown that serum TSH levels below or above the reference range while taking levothyroxine, particularly for prolonged periods of time, may be associated with increased risk of adverse cardiovascular and skeletal events, with some smaller studies also showing increased risk of cognitive disorders. So I think it is imperative that clinicians are aware of this and aim to maintain a euthyroid state in their patients. Saying that, you know, of course, there are several factors why patients may not achieve target TSH levels, and this could be due to medication adherence or non-adherence. This could be that dose adjustments are not being made based on biochemical results, or, you know, patients not taking the medication consistently on an empty stomach, which can reduce its absorption.
And you mentioned skeletal events. What exactly do you mean by that?
Yeah, so particularly studies that have shown patients with what we call iatrogenic hyperthyroidism, so patients who are being treated for hypothyroidism with levothyroxine but end up having low TSH levels, so being on too much thyroid hormone. This has been shown, particularly in postmenopausal women, to increase risk of osteoporosis and fractures.
Thank you so much. I'm Dr. Karen Lasser. I've been speaking today with Dr. Maria Papaleontiou about hypothyroidism. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.